Good morning. I'm Reverend Christian Dement, pastor here at La Mesa First United Methodist Church and in the neighborhood. I welcome you to worship this morning. I invite you to find attached all the links you'll need for this hour of worship, to our website, to our bulletin with music, an attendance card to fill out, and to the giving page for our time of offering. You'll also find a link to our most recent e-newsletter. This past Wednesday was Ash Wednesday, marking the beginning of this new season we're in called Lent. Lent comes from a Latin word that roughly means 40. It is a 40-day season, minus Sundays, of preparation for Easter, emulating the 40 days that Jesus spent in the wilderness after his baptism that we're going to hear about later on in the service. Lent is a season of reflection, a time of repentance, a time to turn away from sin and seek Christ's forgiveness, and a time to return our lives towards Jesus. It's a time of recognizing temptation around us and in us, our woundedness as individuals and a society, and our need for reconciliation with family, friends, and ultimately with God. It is a time of reorientation and a time to remind us of our need for a Savior, the one who was without sin, who sacrificed all for the forgiveness of all, our Lord Jesus Christ. So although this is the beginning of Lent, I want us to start with the end in mind, and that end is a glorious celebration of God defeating our greatest fears of sin and death through Christ's resurrection on Easter. This is what we celebrate today and every Sunday, and why we don't count Sundays in Lent, as each are a mini Easter. So let us begin this holy season with that in mind, knowing that although Lent is a time of reflection and repentance, spiritual discipline, and simple living, it is all leading us to the heavenly banquet that is the kingdom of God, experienced in Christ Jesus' resurrection. Let us fully give ourselves to the worship of this God of grace today.
Good morning. We're the DeBoer family. I'm Tiffany.
I'm Jonathan.
I'm Aaliyah.
And I'm Adam.
And we want to welcome you to worship this morning. Let us pray together. God of storms and rainbows, of rain and sunshine, of all creation, we worship and adore you today. We gaze in wonder at the beauty of your creation and marvel at stormy skies transformed with the vibrant colors of a rainbow. We praise you today for the everlasting sign of your love and care for the whole creation in your desire to preserve life. At Jesus' baptism, the sky revealed your love when you identified him as your beloved son, strengthening him with the same spirit who empowers and strengthens each of us. For all these assurances of your love for us and for the whole creation, we praise and worship you, O God, in the power of the Holy Spirit and in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Amen.
May God bless us all in this time of worship together.
Let's all sing, Lord, who throughout these 40 days, with the words provided.
Lord, who throughout these 40 days for us did fast and pray, teach us with thee to mourn our sins and
abide with
This is the time in our worship service that I invite the children to gather around their computer, phone, or TV and spend a moment with me. I open up this quilt, creating space for our children of all ages in our sanctuary. And I want to share with you all just a little bit about the story we're about to hear. And it's about promises. I'm guessing that many of you, like me, have made promises. Maybe you've promised to take out the trash or clean up your room. And maybe, like me, you haven't held to your promises. We feel bad when we make a promise and we don't keep it, right? Well, the story that we're going to hear is about a promise that God makes with all of us. It's the story of a great flood that God sends because people were not treating each other kindly. And after the great flood, God starts creation all over again with Noah and animals of all types. And God says, I now will keep a promise with you. I'll never send destruction again, but I ask you to promise the same for one another, that you love one another and treat each other with kindness. And to remember this promise, I'm going to give you a bow in the sky, a rainbow. And so every time we see that symbol in the sky, we're reminded of God's promise of love for us and that we're supposed to love one another. Sometimes we need reminders, not only about God's promise, but our promise to one another. I have this really great book that has coins that share the stories of the Bible. A friend of mine, Janet, who lives in that round house on top of Mount Helix that rotates, she gave it to me the first week I came to this church. And in this book is a coin that is the story of Noah's Ark. It reminds us again of that story and of God's promise. We put ashes on our heads this past Wednesday for Ash Wednesday, and I had a pocket filled with crosses that I wanted to give out to children and youth as a reminder of God's love and of Christ's promise to forgive us always. We have a lot of symbols around us to remind us that God loves us and that God makes a promise with us. And those reminders are also good to remind us that we need to keep the promises to one another. And the greatest promise we can make is to love each other and to care for one another, just as God has loved and cared for us. I pray that in this season of Lent, these 40 days before Easter, we continue to follow those promises and keep those promises, just as God keeps God's promise with us. God bless you today and every day. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Ron Byerly. I'm a member of the Caring Ministries team. We offer prayers for our community at the La Mesa and beyond. If you would like to add a prayer for yourself, or maybe a family member or a friend, please email us at caringministry@lamesaumc.com. And now, if you would all join me for our community prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for everything that you do. We ask that you just make us stronger in our beliefs. And we ask that you never stop doing these things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And so we pray today for Dan Bailey, our pianist, whose father suffered a stroke on Monday and was hospitalized. We pray for his continued healing and recovery. For Bill Irwin, Esther Brasmer's husband, who had surgery to remove a small piece of bone resting on a sciatic nerve. He has been in excruciating pain and unable to stand up or walk. And so we pray that the surgery was successful and he experienced a complete healing and comfort from pain. Also for Esther Brasmer's daughter, for a new job. She has been invited back for a second interview with a company that seems to be a good fit. And so we pray for success for her and for all parties involved. We lift up Paul McDaniel for a successful surgery for kidney stones coming this week. For Rich Meller, who is needing patience and healing after a successful double knee joint replacement this week. We pray as he is in rehabilitation for the next couple of months and Also pray for his wife Muriel as she cares for him. We lift up our dear friend Ann Buffington as she has a new diagnosis of cancer. We pray healing, wise medical support, decisions, and treatment, and we surround her in our love and our comfort. We lift up Phyllis Magliona and her daughter Mary, sister and niece of Mary Odendahl. Prayers are for comfort, peace, and compassion, and a strengthened family relationship, as Phyllis has dementia and is declining, while Mary is being treated with chemotherapy for cancer. We pray for Tom Nurmi, Mary Paul's brother, for comfort as he deals with health issues. For Jason Williamson and his family, friends, and neighbors, for holiness and healing. For Norm Sally, for healing and patience, as Norm has two fractures in his ankle following a fall this last week. He is waiting for a determination on whether he'll need surgery, and so we pray strength for him and for his wife, Nancy, as she cares for him. And as always, we hold in prayer hope and promise as we see the results of hard work, sacrifice, and vaccines as cases of COVID decrease. We hold on to the light that seems to grow just a little brighter as we move toward a hopeful end to this pandemic. And finally, we pray for all of those dealing with extreme weather, and especially those in Texas who are experiencing a lack of power and electricity and water. May there be solutions to this emergency, and may lives be saved and people be comforted and kept safe. There is so much to pray for today. We pray for all of these things that have been spoken and those that remain on our hearts this morning. Let us now take time in silence to lift these prayers to God. Let us pray. Loving, creating God, you are in covenant with your people. You have pledged to be our God and ask us to be your people, trusting in you in all our ways. But we find many excuses to prevent us from really trusting you. We erect barriers before our faith journey even begins. Our time, obligations, energy all become part of the building up of these barriers. We give talk much about our faith journey. We dream about what it would be like to truly place our hand in yours and follow you. But when it comes to actually making the journey, our time constraints and weak commitments loom largely before us. Help us, O God, to tear down these barriers. Make us ready for the journey by replacing the fear in our hearts with a sense of joy and challenge of self-discovery and discipleship. Remind us that in service to you, helping others, we will also find ourselves made more fully whole. As we have spoken the names of our friends and family members and other situations in which healing and comfort are needed, let us remember that we too stand in need of prayer and healing. Make us ready to receive your good news and then to be witnesses to your love to all your people, as we do when we join our voices as one, praying your Son's prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Dust and ashes touch our face, mark our failure and our falling. Holy Spirit, come, walk with us to take us as disciples, washed and wakened by your calling. Take us by the hand and lead us
Let us pray. Righteous God, we mark these early days in Lent with reminders of your covenant with us. In your judgment, you sent the great flood, yet you saved a faithful remnant. You followed with a covenant not to use the flood again. As we prepare to offer our gifts to you, we are reminded that we have been spared from judgment by your Son, our Savior, who took on our guilt and bore our judgment. May gratitude for his sacrifice move us to offer not only money, but our whole being. In Christ we pray. Amen.
Hi, I'm Mary Ernest. I'm the Worship and Arts Committee Chair here at La Mesa First. Before beginning this seasonal sharing with you this morning, I think you should know that I love the use of metaphor. When I'm exploring a topic, to be able to find something seemingly unrelated that still gives me the opportunity to explore relationships and connections often deepens my understanding of the topic. And many times it will even give me a different perspective that I wouldn't have considered to look at the topic, whatever it is that I'm exploring. So you will find that this sharing really contains a lot of metaphors this morning. And we're going to start with the metaphor of God as the potter, which many of you may be familiar with. God is the potter taking a common substance and shaping each of us individually into the beings that we are. I think this metaphor can be further extended with the consideration of kintsugi. This is the ancient Japanese art of restoring broken objects, usually pottery. The artisans first glue the pieces back together using a lacquer, and then they highlight the fracture lines by dusting them with a precious metal, usually gold. This art form does not simply restore the usefulness of the object, but it shows the importance of the history of the object by refusing to hide the evidence of the repairs that have been made. Or if you will, refuses to hide the wear, the brokenness, the suffering that the piece has undergone. The finished repaired form shows no shame in presenting the restoration of the piece. And if you look for pieces that have been restored through Kintsugi, you will often find that they're, I think, even more beautiful than in their original form. I think it's interesting to note that when they take the lacquer from the tree, which is the sap of the tree, that this requires a sacrifice of the tree. It ends its life. And there you have, I think, another metaphor as we enter the season of Lent and follow Jesus' footsteps and journey to the cross on our behalf. While no one takes suffering easily or lightly, and while some losses in our lives cannot simply be replaced or filled, like in the art of Kintsugi, through our faith in God, we hold the possibility of filling the cracks and the holes in our lives, and we can be made whole again, and perhaps even more beautiful for our suffering.
Our first reading today comes from Genesis chapter 9, verses 8 through 17. Then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, "As for me, I am establishing my covenant with you and your descendants after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the domestic animals, and every animal of the earth with you, as many as came out of the ark. I establish my covenant with you that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of a flood, and never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth." God said, "This is the sign of the covenant that I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for all future generations. I have set my bow in the clouds, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth and the bow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh, and the waters shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. When the bow is in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth." God said to Noah, "This is the sign of the covenant that I have established between me and all flesh that is on the earth."
Our second reading today comes from Mark chapter 1, verses 9 through 15. In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee, and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. A voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." And the Spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness. He was in the wilderness 40 days, tempted by Satan. And he was with the wild beasts, and the angels waited on him. Now after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God, and saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." May God add his blessings to the reading and hearing of the word.
Will you join me in these words of preparation? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. The first verse in the first chapter of the first book of the Hebrew Bible, or the Old Testament, in Genesis, begins with chaos. It goes like this. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Before creation, when nothing existed, there was water, the chaos of water, the primordial deep, the absence of God and all that is. And then God creates. God creates order out of chaos. God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good. God created order from that chaos, beginning with that separation from light and dark to create day and night. Creation begins. As the creation story continues, each time God creates something new, God calls it good. And by the sixth day, when God creates humankind in God's image, God blesses it all and calls it all very good. But as we read on, things start to turn, and turn fairly quickly. Things go from very good to somewhat bad as humanity starts to turn itself against one another and ultimately against God's will in God's creation, causing God to want to hit the restart button by only verse 7 in this first book. God threatens a great flood and enlists Noah to build an ark and collect two of every living thing, male and female. And by the end of the seventh chapter, all of creation is back in the deep. The water threatens and chaos returns. God, our creator, is dissatisfied with all of creation so much so that he wipes out in a colossal do-over everything, a rebooting of the entire universe. As the story goes, rain pours down for 40 days and 40 nights, and the waters flooded all of the land and all that was saved in this chaotic moment is what Noah put on the ark. This is such a powerful story that many books and movies have been based on it, and even a man in Kentucky, his name's Ken Ham, built a whole theme park around it. He calls it the Ark Encounter, and it includes a full-scale Noah's Ark, constructed with the dimensions described in the Bible, 510 feet long, 85 feet wide, and 51 feet high. The theme park even has a zoo. It's a powerful story, one that is worth telling over and over and maybe even recreating in some ways. Well, as we go deeper into the story, after a good year or so, God causes the water to recede, the land dries up, the animals are let go to begin creation again. We can call it recreation. It's in Genesis 9, then, that everything changes. God, the creator, becomes God, the protector of all that God has created, choosing to stand with that which was created out of nothing. And God says, I have set my bow in the clouds. We read this today as rainbow because that's the word we've created around the text. It creates a beautiful image, something that we see on a somewhat regular basis, maybe not so much here in Southern California where we don't get as much rain, but it is something that we see every once in a while. It serves as a beautiful expression of God's creation and recreation and of God's promise, God's covenant with humanity. But did you know that the original Hebrew word isn't that feature of light and color so much as it might be pointing us towards a weapon of war? Did you hear that the word that is used in the scripture is a bow, not a rainbow? Hebrew uses the word keshet for both a bow as a weapon, used with arrows to defeat an enemy, as well as a rainbow. But oftentimes it's that first meaning that is primary in the Hebrew language. Now, there's a lot of scholarly work around this, and I won't get into it too far, but it may be that that bow that is written about in this Genesis story alludes more to a bow that is used with an arrow as much as a rainbow. In the flood story, God triumphs over chaos. The chaos in the flood story represents the violence of humanity that has corrupted the earth. The flood is God's natural agent to cleanse the earth from the violence of humanity, the fighting against one another, rather than loving God and loving neighbor as God intended in creation. And after the waters of the flood recede, God hangs his bow in the sky, not as a triumphant weapon, but instead a sign of peace, of God's promise that the flood will never come again. Rabbinic commentators observe that the bow is pointed away from, not toward, humanity or the earth, as it was customary in the time for warriors to invert their instruments of war, which they held in their hands when calling for peace against an opponent. And to take it one step further, that bow has no rope to bend the arrows. This is why God places his bow in the sky, pointing away from the earth. God's placing his bow in the sky is a metaphor, a visible symbol of his promise to desist from global destruction. God announces that the rainbow is a sign of his covenant with the earth and all living things. This covenant includes rules and reciprocal obligations for God, humans, and all animals. Humans now can only kill animals for food, but they must not eat their lifeblood, as it is written. No one, humans nor animals, may kill humans because humans are made in God's image. These new laws regulate violence on earth, and they are incumbent on all living creatures. And in return, by living into this promise, God promises never again to send a flood. This is the new harmonious order of a post-flood era. The rainbow, as a sign of this covenant, reminds God of God's promise, but it also reminds us that we are reassured that God will remember the covenant and keep God's promise. Despite how hard the rain falls, life on earth will continue. Those who see the rainbow are reminded of this story and how violence and bloodshed lead to destruction, but it's the destruction of one another, not so much God's destruction of us. For God says, "I am setting aside my weapon that I used to bring destruction to the people. I am shifting to become a protector of all of creation." Interestingly, the word bow in verse 13 has a curious configuration, as scholars point out. Some translators aren't quite sure how to translate it, actually. But the word that is attached in that particular instance is a word that in other places is translated as plowshare. It's possible that God is performing the act that later the prophet Isaiah calls upon all the nations to perform, to turn weapons of war into farming implements, swords into plowshares. This is a complete reorientation of the relationship between God and God's people. So the sign carries so much more significance than we might have first thought. We must consider how to become then the sign that God is with us in a world that feels so adversarial these days. How can we move beyond pointing at the signs of God at work in the world, which is important, but also being the sign that God is with us to the world? Well, I subscribe to this website called This Is Colossal. It is a site for contemporary art and visual expressions from around the world. I get a weekly update and get to peer into the beauty of photographic art and other forms. And I came across this expression. It's by Pedro Reyes, a Mexican artist who created this project titled Palas por Pistolas. Reyes collected 1,527 guns from his community, offering those who gave up their weapons a coupon that allowed them to buy electronics and appliances. He took those guns that he collected and steamrolled them in public and melted them down to create shovels that were then used for planting trees, taking these instruments of war and turning them into instruments of new creation. Since its completion, public schools and art institutions from around the world, from Canada and Europe to San Francisco, have all received shovels for community members to use to plant trees. Could this be a modern expression of placing down our bows, those instruments that are instruments of violence that pit human against human and create violence here, into an opportunity for God's continued creation as we are partners in that creation? When we become co-creators with God, as opposed to those who contend against God's creation, we become signs and symbols of God's promise and covenant, like the rainbow. We don't need to wait for it to rain anymore to remember the covenant and the promise. We become living examples of that rainbow and that promise. I've had the experience throughout this month to spend time with the children of our Children's Center and to teach a lesson to each grade level. And this month's lesson was about words that build up, words that repair, and words that tear down. It's so important that not only are we an example for the people around us, but that we teach the future generations that we are creators with God. And that when we are using words that build up, like I love you, I like you, I care about you, that these are things that create the people of peace that God intended. And when we use words of repair, like I'm sorry, or I need your forgiveness, I apologize, then we continue to create the community in which God intended in that first creation, and even in that second creation after the flood. For we are called to be symbols to one another of God's promise of creation to each other. Like the rainbow, we are to be reminding people of that great story of God's covenant with us. I also think of the moment that we had earlier this week as we placed ashes on the foreheads of not only members of our church, but people in the community. On this day that carries so much symbolism about mortality and sin, things that are rather depressing and somber, people walked away saying, "This made my day," and welled up with tears of gratitude for receiving a symbol of God's grace. For those who were served on Wednesday, they now see that this is a church that is a symbol of God's promise, God's hope, and God's grace, much like the rainbow is a symbol of God's covenant with God's people. We as individuals and we corporately as the church are to become that symbol to one another. For the rainbow is a sign of many things. It is a visual sign of the covenant between God and all living creatures, a glittering and mysterious bridge between sky and earth. It is a sign of peace and reconciliation and the eternity of moral laws between humanity. We remember these things, sometimes subconsciously. When the rains let up and the sun shines through the clouds, creating that momentary wonder of the rainbow, we are reminded physically. Although we know that the rainbow is a natural effect of light after rain, it is also a sign of a biblical memory in our lives and perceptions. And here's the connection between this story and us as followers of Christ in this season of Lent. Jesus came as the rainbow personified. Jesus came out of his birth and out of his baptism as a sign that God is present and that God is our advocate and not our adversary. So part of the work for us in this season of Lent is to take these 40 days as Jesus did and as God did to assess how well we are doing in following that example and being that sign. That the rending of our hearts, both as individuals and as a church, is in the confession that we may have been more of an adversary to the work of God's creation in this world than an advocate at times. And whether we think individually or corporately, we need to examine the condition of our hearts and ask whether we can look at ourselves and look at the church and declare, this is the sign. This is the sign of hope, the sign of promise, and the sign of grace. A grace that liberates us and frees us to be that creation that God intends, that is blessed, and that God can proclaim once again is very good. Amen.
You are forever.
Pastor Christian will be leading a book study on Wednesday evenings starting February 24th at 6:30 p.m. called Savior, What the Bible Says About the Cross. Here's a little clip with more information.
Have you ever found yourself asking what the cross of the Christian faith really means? Or what exactly did Jesus do on the cross, and why was it necessary? And what does it mean for us today? Hi, I'm McGray DeVega, author of Savior, What the Bible Says About the Cross. In my new book and Bible study experience, we're going to examine these questions by considering how the Bible describes Jesus' death and how it brings reconciliation between sinful humankind and a holy God. No single image or metaphor fully captures the meaning of Jesus' death and resurrection. The Bible uses several metaphors, each illuminating a different facet of how the cross brings salvation. Each week, we will explore the pros and the cons of these images while developing a greater awareness of our own sin and an appreciation to God's faithful love. But you know what? Studying these biblical ways of speaking about Jesus' death ought to be more than just an intellectual thought exercise. It should also deepen our love for God and other people, and it should also strengthen our commitment to follow Jesus. For those reading the book with others, we've created a 6-week Bible study experience specifically for the season of Lent that includes a leader guide and a DVD with video sessions for each week. Through this study, my hope is that your understanding of the cross may be deepened, that your behavior shaped by the power of the Holy Spirit, and that your commitment to Christ might be strengthened. Ultimately, my prayer is that you will be inspired by God's love for you, revealed by the work of Jesus Christ on the cross.
Sign up for the class and purchase the book through our e-newsletter or contact Pastor Christian directly. Our Creative Care Ministry planning team invites you to 2 events this month: a Save Your Scraps webinar, an online class to discover why it is so important to keep organic waste from reaching the landfill, with tools you'll need to stop wasting food and money in your home, on Saturday, February 20th from 10 to 11 a.m. Our Creation Care Ministry planning team invites you to 2 events this month: a Save Your Scraps webinar, an online class to discover why it is so important to keep our organic waste from reaching the landfill, with tools you'll need to stop wasting food and money in your home, on Saturday, February 20th from 10 to 11 a.m. Also, you're invited to attend the film screening and a discussion after of Sowing Seeds of Change, Revisioning Agriculture in North America, a film produced by a UMC group dedicated to sharing stories about how communities and individuals resist destructive social structures and environmental degradation to create a better world, on February 26th at 7 p.m. Finally, along with our regular occurring studies and gatherings online, you're invited to our movie discussion group on Friday, March 5th at 6 p.m., when we will discuss A Love Divided, which you can find for free on YouTube. More information and links to all this and more can be found in the e-newsletter attached to this worship service.
And just before we close, I want to share that I feel like you do the excitement of seeing COVID cases decreasing and the promise of more of our community opening up. I want to let you know that we have a team of people in our church that are actively discussing and planning getting back to in-person worship soon. Please be patient, though, as we are doing all we can to do this in the most intentional and safe way we can for all people. But look for updates and surveys in upcoming newsletters so that we can hear your feelings about reopening and help guide us in our plans. And now, may the God of our baptism be the God of every blessing in our lives. May favor and peace be multiplied in us so much that we have to give some of it away. And may we forever be reminded that it is God and our Savior, Christ Jesus, through the Holy Spirit, that sustains us and makes us whole. And may we go forth now in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we pray, until we gather again. Amen.
The next piece that I'm about to play for the postlude, I'd like to dedicate to one of my favorite pianists of all time, Chick Corea. He passed away last week on February 9th. And he is one of the most regarded pianists, composers, band leaders of the last 60 years or more. He worked with such greats as Miles Davis, Herbie Hancock, Keith Jarrett, and more. Many of his compositions are regarded as jazz standards, such as Armando's Rumba, the piece I'm about to play called Spain. So again, it's a great loss to the music world and everybody who's enjoyed his music, but it will live on forever, and we are certainly lucky to have had him. So, all right.